She keeps telling prisons are dark, grey, and whatever shades of grey exist, she has brought it out all and has made it even more interesting than 50 Shades of Grey.
Which is not at all interesting, it's quite boring.
Okay. Yes. So definitely, okay, I don't know that.
Sorry.
50 Shades of Grey I haven't read, but of course Sunetra's book, I've read it almost like a Bible. Because, and I'm I was very surprised when I read her book, how she has brought out everything that happens in prison. Not an iota of what happens there is left out. In all its minuscule, minute details, she has mentioned it. And she has interviewed these 13 people in her book. And through them, she has learned whatever happens there. And of course, she has collected the case diaries from police, the court judgments, and putting all that, and of course, her journalistic experience. Because when these famous people went to jail, like Amar Singh or Mr. Peter Mukherjee or whoever, what ensued prior to that, we all know from media, of course, and we have forgotten. But that journalistic experience, when she was running after those stories as a journalist, all that she has put in and makes it a very interesting reading, no less than a thriller. my pleasure. The main point of, as the name itself says, it is Behind Bars, Prison Tales of India's Most Famous. So she has concentrated on the famous people there and has tried to say how prisons are supposed to be levelers, but they are not, unfortunately. The VIPs, the famous people, do get VIP treatment even inside jails when they are not entitled to. And my work is in a way similar. When I was posted as DIG Prisons in Bengaluru, I brought out, exposed the special facilities that were being given to AIADMK leader Ms. Shashikala Natarajan, who was herself once upon a time slated to be Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu. So when I brought out these the facilities that were given to her, and later read Sunetra's book, I realized how common it is in India to give VIP treatment to the VIPs, which they're not supposed to. Now that is somewhere a point, though this book is very light, it makes for a light reading, the message conveyed is actually quite serious. I think this is a point from where prison reforms in India have to begin, because see, people who land up in prisons, what kind of people are they? Generally, of course, they would have committed crime, but not all those who commit crime land up in jails. At first level, they get filtered out. If you are able to bribe a policeman, you know, you don't need to face the court. And then if you are able to hire good lawyers, and good lawyers demand huge money. So if you do that, then you will again escape from landing up in jail. So most of the people who land up in jails are poor, actually. They would have committed crime, of course, but there are many who commit crime but still roaming outside the jails. So the people who land up there are those who are poor, who are already oppressed, who have seen inequality, suffered all these. And when they land up in jails, you are again creating the same kind of environment and saying, okay, you are poor, you are going to be given this treatment only. For the poor, actually, the jails are like hell. Whereas for the most influential, the politicians or rich businessmen or the famous people who land up, it doesn't really make so much difference. So you're again continuing the same environment which led them probably to commit crime, the same oppression, the same inequality. You're again reinforcing in jails. And that, I think, is somewhere to be broken. And that should be the point of prison reforms. So could be a starting point.
Well, yeah. I think that was a good starting point. Sunetra, who aids these practices? The prison system, politicians themselves, people with... The most common public perception is India is those with political influence are treated well in prison. Some kind of political influence. Which is perhaps purchased through financial powers. The prison system is also implicit in this preferential treatment of influential prisoners. So how does this cycle ever get broken? If the system itself is sort of creating this kind of hierarchy, then how does this cycle ever get broken?
You know, Roopa, in a way, just when my book came out, Roopa's and what Roopa did of going to that jail, Roopa was tells us how she was only there for less than a month. Mm. In less than a month, Roopa was DIG prisons, and she happened to visit Shashikala's jail, and she happened to go around, do her rounds, which every DIG prison is supposed to do, but the problem is that they don't. And this, you know, there's this cliche that women are less corrupt, women in positions of power are less corrupt than men. But in a way, Roopa really proves that right, because she did her job. She went there and she made the rounds. That's true. Oh my God, look at the irony of it, yeah. So, the problem with all of this, to your question, answering your question is, that the reason all of these things happen is because most people in those positions are not doing their jobs. Most people are not even visiting those places because they think, well, what's the point really? These are disgusting places, the places filled with the dregs of society, as you called them yesterday, the places which filled of rapists and whatever happens, they need to be locked up somewhere. So part of the problem there is that you have the convicts themselves become the prison officials, proxy prison officials, and they perpetrate this reign of terror. So, and they're very happy with a little bit of money that they get from people, because when 2 crores was the money that Roopa said in her report was paid off to give Shashikala a comfortable life inside jail. The 2 crores goes down the ranks to the right to the bottom of the society. Now, all of you may be asking, why does all of this matter to us? But I just wanted to put it into perspective as a journalist as well, that Vijay Mallya's deportation or extradition has become the biggest story for all of us. And you see top anchors sitting there and saying, why is Vijay Mallya not being brought back? Who's not bringing them? There's only one reason that Vijay Mallya is likely to win the case in the UK. And that's the condition of prisons in India. The only reason why UK will not allow Vijay Mallya to be brought back over here is because of the number of people that die in our jails every year, and nobody cares. Nobody asks a question in Parliament or anywhere else. I mean, you talked about the kind of, you know, discrepancy in the treatment that people get, but the worrying thing is not that. The worrying thing is that people die, people are raped. People are raped all the time in jail. Men and women are getting raped all the time. There's one really serious report, which only when I was researching this book did I find out that there is a PUCL report, which was done by PUCL Karnataka, which is like a diary of horror stories, which is Nirbhaya done with so many people. Because one statistic, and there is no like hard statistic, this is an anecdotal thing, is that 90% of transgenders who go to jail get raped. 90% of transgenders. And one of those people are featured in my book. A woman, I'm sorry, I'm talking about not so influential people, but yeah. It's just that you can't tell the prison story. There's Shashikala, who's got, as Roopa told us yesterday, who's got 5 jail cells. She's living there in a compartment which is 5 jail cells, and she's having the cook. As the cook used to come to Raja was very honest. He said, Sunetra, when you're doing a book behind bars, don't talk to me because I was a VIP. They would come every morning and say, Sir, aaj kya lenge khane mein, you know. And then he would say, okay, now I feel like, he said, you know, the coconut water is very good. I would survive on that. And he would have something else for breakfast, lunch. And, you know, he had a good time. So he was honest and said that I had a comfortable life in jail. But there's this woman, there's this beautiful transgender bar dancer from Mumbai, whose only fault was that she and her chelas, she was the guru of a lot of people, she and her chelas had gone to Ajmer Sharif. And they were, as hijras, get picked on by the police a lot. So someone picked a fight with the hijra, one of her chelas, and said, you know, would have harassed them. And they touched them. So there was a bit of a brawl because the other hijras came to their rescue and there was a bit of a brawl. So the police said, chalo thane, and put all of them in jail. And this woman, called Khushi, she gets raped in police custody. And do you know what? We all, and all of us in the media, we've all become sensitized thanks to people like Vrinda, because Vrinda was part of Justice Verma's, she worked on that report as well, and everything that happened after. But nobody cared for the fact that Khushi was raped by four policemen, and there's no charge sheet filed till today. 2012, she was raped, same time as December 16. There's no charge sheet filed today because they said a hijra can't be raped. So they want her to undergo a lie detector test. This is what's happening in our jails. You know, this is the kind of treatment that the horrors that are happening, in jails. I started off this book writing about how this woman I met who wore Versace and Jimmy Choo's in jail. And she told me this very honest story about how she went about doing that. And her story was a story of empowerment because she was rich and she was powerful, but she was also that I'm going to use the law to my advantage and I'm going to use the law and my money to make sure that I dress the way I want to in jail. So she wore her designer outfits and she fought for the right to have a Western commode instead of and to have an LCD TV in her jail cell. So her story is a different kind of story. But when I did that, I also, while researching it, I also found people like Khushi who were getting raped in jail, or people like Wahid who were being tortured to the point that they were urinating blood. Now, this is happening in our prisons as well. And I think that we should all be aware of this when we ask why Vijay Mallya has run away with all our money. Because, and the only reason he's not going to come back is because of
the condition of Indian jails.
Yeah.
I think, Vrinda, you've been scribbling a lot of notes. I know I was. I didn't want to embarrass you. I didn't want to sort of press the point. But you've made a lot of notes there. Just to start off, what is the law? I mean, I was asking Roopa that also. Are there laws in place to protect prisoners, the rights of prisoners? Does India have those laws? I mean, whether they're implemented or not, but, you know.
See, in terms of the prison, there are laws which say you cannot kill, rape a prisoner who is there. Of course, there are some rules, and Roopa would know that better than me, which allow some amount of physical punishment to be given to certain kinds of prisoners. To my mind, this is all a carryover of our caste system, where we think that people have to be put in their place through use of physical violence or the threat of physical violence. And that we today see is part of our rules and procedures which govern the prison system. And the reason why I think a book like Sunetra's is extremely welcome, this is not a topic we talk about. It's almost like everybody is so delighted that, oh, there are some bad people, some criminals who are put away. And it seems to take care of a level of social anxiety, which is a legitimate social anxiety, because there is a high rate of physical, social insecurity that we live in across the country today. But instead of asking the right questions and holding the right people accountable, we are happy to say some people are put away. Let's not talk about them. And in 2013, I recall when I came here, it was a panel that Aparna Sen was hosting on the death penalty, which at that time, and just as both of them just said, nobody asked questions. So one of the persons accused of the rape of Jyoti Pandey committed suicide. Is anybody even curious to know where is the report? After all, there is a custodial death. Somebody needs to do an inquiry. Has anybody asked, where is that report? I, for one, would really like to know, how did this man commit suicide? Was it a suicide? We don't know whether it's a suicide. But we don't ask those questions because we're like, oh, he's a bad man, I don't need to know. And I think that's what the entire system is today playing on. As she said, it's hell in there. And that's, we're hearing from somebody who's an IPS officer. And insofar as the laws and rules are concerned, who will ask the question that is the law being broken? Because when Roopa asked that question in her capacity as an IPS officer, she was transferred. I'll just mention one. Who else asks these questions? So some of you may have heard the name of an Adivasi activist leader called Soni Sori, a woman who faced sexual custodial torture while in police custody, then sent to prison. While in prison, she was able to leak out information to her lawyers in the form of letters to say what is happening to her. And because I've represented Soni in Bastar, and she's a very determined person, and she says, look, this is wrong, what was done to me? So somebody needs to be held to account. She named the police officer, who was, of course, given the President's Gallantry Award, a man named by her for having committing sexual torture on her under his charge. They started doing a cavity search, stripping her naked and doing cavity search on Soni in jail, particularly when she had to go to the court. Word reached many of us, and in Delhi, we pestered and pressurized the National Commission for Women. In the statute governing the National Commission of Women is a provision that they have to look at prisons in the country. National Commission for Women doesn't bother doing that. It's in the mandate of the NHRC. It's written in the law. It's in the mandate of the NCW. With a lot of difficulty, NCW put together a team. We were able to persuade them to take somebody from outside. They took Annie Raja, who's a CPI NFIW leader, to accompany them. That report has never been made public till date of that NCW visit to jails in Chhattisgarh. Eventually, Annie Raja released her portion of the report, saying, if I have gone on this visit, I have to tell people what is it that I saw. I visited Jagdalpur jail as part of a study that I've been doing on looking at prisons in a conflict area. Through whatever ways I was able to get access. It's not just Soni Sori's story of torture. Her nephew, Lingaram Kodopi, who's also one of the first Adivasi journalists of Bastar. If you look at his medical record in prison, it says he has piles. Linga is somebody I've known very well and very closely for many years now. And I had a detailed conversation with him. And he said, they put chilies in a stick and thrust it up my anus. When the medical doctor records it, it's recorded as piles. What is the form of torture that happens? It doesn't get documented in any medical record. So if we say this is what was done to him, you'll be confronted with a medical document which will say piles. It will not say torture. Transgender people today under the law have no protection from sexual assault of any kind. And it's something they've been agitating about, and they are extremely vulnerable, particularly from the police and others. So there are rules and laws in place, but if you are going to invoke any of them, you are going to be at a very severe receiving end. And secondly, there are also gaps in law. We don't have a law against torture in this country. We are all very excited about being the largest democracy. It's a phrase that the Indian state uses in Geneva at the UN. You can actually count how many times they say it. It's like every sentence they say it twice. We are the largest democracy, we have a constitution. That's very good. We don't have a law against torture. Kim Devi, Vijay Malaya cannot be held to account in this country because our laws do not provide basic human rights protection. So we can go berserk, present company excluded, on television at 9, frothing that we have to hold these people to account. It won't happen. It's better to look a little closely at the system. And the last thing before I want to say just now is that something that both of them said, you carry into prison all your social privileges as well as your vulnerabilities, your marginalizations, and your discrimination. It doesn't change inside the prison.
Roopa, if the situation is so grim, I mean, you tried,
there are some good things happening also in prison. Okay. For example, many people study, good people actually study, they don't while away time, as Sunetra has brought out in her book, there was this tandoor murderer, Manu Sharma, who used to perform pujas, Sushil Sharma. So he performed pujas and havans. So there are people who keep on praying, engage in meditation. Of course, vipassana is taught all over India now in all jails. There are people who get degrees. There are in my own Bengaluru jail, there were few persons. There was one person who did masters in 2-3 subjects, including journalism and law, and was doing some kind of PhD, had enrolled. There is this, she herself mentions, this Pappu Yadav, he got a degree from IGNO on human rights and natural disasters and so on. So there are good people. Now, there is this National Crime Records Bureau, which says 60% of the prisoners are those who are inside for murders. Baki, another 40% are mainly for cheating, rapes, and of course, nexalism and terrorism and so on. But the major chunk come from murders. So even in this murder, another major chunk within murders come from not the cold-blooded murders, but murders done at the spur of the moment. You pick up a fight and then suddenly in the rage, you kill the person. So they are those who are inside for that. And when you go inside the jail, be it as an officer or, yes, mainly as an officer, because nobody else goes into the jail. No RTI activist goes, no social activists go, because they can't go. Because after all, when I was doing my work, my jail superintendent, Sina Thanke, told me nobody can get inside the jail without my permission. So that is why they remain dark dungeons, because nobody visits them. Whatever happens, whatever the fiefdom, it's a fiefdom of the jail officers. If they are good, the prisoners are also, you know, better off. And if they are demonic, then God save the prisoners. So this being the case, where even for the officers, it's very difficult. The prison officials, just imagine you have to day in and day out within those four walls, you have to see these people who have committed crime and who have nothing much to look up to for those many years that they're inside. It's a very depressing environment. And when I first joined, when I listened to some stories, I was, by the end of the day, the first day when I visited, I was too depressed. Like, for example, I'll just tell you one or two stories. There was this woman. When I met her the first day, she was about 35 years old. She had already spent 5 years in prison. That means when she was 30, she entered for murder. Murder of whom? Her own child. So I was surprised. Then I asked, what is the story? She said, one day I was teaching, trying to call my child to come and study, sit and study, there is exam. And he was not listening. And then maine ek thappad mara. And then he somehow went and hit a thing where, you know, he fell on a sharp thing and he suddenly died. And then after that, trial went on and she was held guilty. And she's now inside the jail for culpable homicide. But the worst part is not that. the even worse part is, after she came into jail, she had another child who was above 5. So if you have children above 5 years, you can't keep them inside the jail with you. The mother can't keep. Only if the children are below 5 years, you can keep them with you. So there was the second child who was a little above 5 years when she entered the jail. So she could not get her into to stay along with her. So that was another depressing factor. She lost the first daughter anyway. And the second daughter was also separated. And even worse is, now the man is married to another woman. So she doesn't know what to do, or she doesn't have hope what she will do after she goes out of the prison. Then there's another there was another man. He was 18. He's from Fatehpur in UP. He comes down to Bengaluru in search of livelihood. He sets up a pan shop. And you know, local, there is always, in every city, in every region, there is always a tussle between locals and non-locals. So he got into one such tussle with localites. And they also attacked him, and his group also attacked, and he killed someone in that dispute. And then he landed up in jail. Now, when I saw him, he was 32 years old recently when I met him inside the jail. And he has gone through hell. Nobody came ever to meet him because, first of all, he was a non-local. He was very poor. His relatives, neither father or mother, could afford to kharchify on the travel expenses and come and meet him. They couldn't spend that much money. They couldn't afford. And worst part is, he learned about his mother's death after 3 years. His mother died sometime. He couldn't even get to know. After 3 years, somehow he came to know. And now he doesn't know when he comes out of jail after a few years. He doesn't know where he will stay, whether he wants to go back. He's not sure how his community will receive him or how his relatives will receive him and so on. So there are very depressing stories like this. And most of these people who commit, let's say Kolkata, many people come here from other regions like Jharkhand, UP, everywhere, Bihar and so on. So suppose they come and commit a crime here. Somebody cheats, or more than cheating, let's say small chore, chindi chore, somebody thieves some paltry thing. So you are inside the jail and you are arrested and sent inside, but then you are a non-local, so sometimes you're not even, you don't want to tell your parents that I am now inside the jail, because as it is, you have fought with your parents and come to another city. So there are many people languishing like that. After charge sheet, they are just forgotten, no trial takes place, there is no advocate for them. Sometimes, just after arrest, they are forgotten, the charge sheets also don't move up, they don't even get charge sheeted, the police also forgets the case. So this is what happens, and such people are many. Though there is District Legal Services Authority, which is supposed to give free legal aid, there is apathy. The members don't visit the jails. They don't ask who wants lawyers or advocates, and their basic rights of getting legal aid are violated. Then the prisons are, a board of infections. People come, since they're all mostly poor, you know, their nutrition level, health, hygiene, it's all also poor. And therefore, when they come inside, they are more prone to picking up getting infected from others. And one major thing in all the jails is tuberculosis. So generally, when somebody comes, he is not tested for tuberculosis. He is kept amidst others, and the others are also at risk of developing tuberculosis. So the best way I would feel in all the prisons is, the moment one comes inside the jail, which I started in Bengaluru, the moment somebody lands up in jail, the first day, put him through all the tests, tuberculosis, other infectious diseases, including HIV. We got the medical kits and started the test. So that it serves twofold purposes. One is early treatment. If you are recognized to have some disease, HIV or TB, you can start early treatment. And sometimes if there are infectious diseases like TB, separate them out. Of course, HIV you can't, but TB, you keep them in a separate ward so that others don't pick up the infection. So these are all minor things for prison reforms, of course, which can be picked up from her book as well.
Now, can I just
And which got you transferred also. Your attempts to put these in place got you. So that was my point. How do you break out? You can, of course
no,
you can.
I just wanted to say that, you know, talk about Vipassana being there, that, you know, it's a good thing that's there. Oh, yeah, can I just tell everyone that Kalmadi...
I heard the story the other day at that
Kalmadi
venue.
Kalmadi spent his entire jail cell in Vipassana. Why? Because it's the most comfortable part to be in. Kalmadi. Yeah, because it was really comfortable, it was there, so everybody else wasn't there, so he wasn't
engaged only in Vipassana. I mean.
Whereas everybody else, there's no psychologist, nothing. So this is, you know, there are huge problems with this.
So the thing is, we've sort of momentarily talked about popular perceptions about how these are bad people, they need to be put in jail. A lot of the people in this book also are technically, I mean, they are bad people. They've done some very seriously bad things. I'm now representing the sort of common voice and saying that these are people who are guilty of some really serious major crimes. And their punishment is that they have been sent to jail. When does punishment end? Yesterday, Devdutt Patanayak did a session here where he said, when does punishment end? Do you deserve to be further punished once you have landed in jail, which was your punishment anyway? Is being in jail punishment enough? Who decides? So, Sunetra, was that one of the motivators behind your book? You know, why else would you write a book about these people who have done some pretty dicey things in their lives, you know? Let's face it.
Well, you know, I chose these people because to some extent, I could empathize. You can't write about people without empathizing with them. And I do empathize with the Tandoor murderer as well. I could understand, and it fascinated me as a person to think that... I couldn't understand that, you know, what are we all capable of doing? You know,
anybody can commit murder. Anybody, any one of us.
You should also have...
Critically, we are all murderers. That's what Vrinda... anybody, given the right situation...
I think the way she writes particularly about that case, because, you know, when you read in the newspaper, when we had all read about this case, it's so grisly, and he says, yes, I did get her, the body to dispose of the body.
He just says, I didn't cut her up.
Correct, but he doesn't say, I didn't dispose it of through the tandoor.
Yeah,
he actually only says, I didn't hack. Yeah. Now, I'm not sure that makes a huge difference to people sitting here, how grisly it is. But what is he saying? He's exactly what Roopa said. He said it happened at a moment. He was full of rage. And in that momentary rage, he killed somebody. And I think the law is extremely problematic because it does not distinguish between this moment of rage, which can actually overcome any human being. And to then, I think the question that she's asked is so pertinent. Can you talk about prisons without talking about crime and punishment? And increasingly, the courts are giving remainder of life. What is the purpose? What is the point? What is happening in these hell holes? Why do you want that person to stay there forever? And it's all being done in our name, that we want this to be done.
Collective conscience.
The people who demand that, you know, these punishments be handed out. But what is actually punished, the scope of the punishment?
For example...
These people are not being punished further. I mean, the people you have written about...
No, but all of them, it all seems too much. For example, this boy who is an NRI, and there's a red corner notice out in his name because he dealt with, his car was in possession of ecstasy or whatever in the US. So he got bad advice from someone and he went off to Dubai and he lived there and he was very successful. He was a well-off businessman. Somehow the India became very aware of the red corner notice and he was caught when he landed in Mumbai. And he tells the story, and he's really young, he's really good looking. And he tells the story of how his friend who was caught in the car with him, he went and served his sentence in the US. It was 6 months, he went to jail and he was out. He was here in jail in India for 4.5 years.
Even now, as an under trial, even now the case is going on in high court, it's going on, and because he's been in jail, he hasn't got a job, he hasn't got anything. I mean, where does the punishment end?
Not as an under trial. He was,
he had done something in, carried drugs in US.
So he was on an extradition proceedings. He's only in detention. You're right. He's only in detention.
So there is no heaven and hell, as we say, up or anywhere. It's very much here, and you know, you do something and you land up in jails, then that is hell.
No, so only if you're poor also.
Yeah.
It's not for everybody. I think...
But then it's relative, you know, nobody, even politicians, they wouldn't like to land up in jails, you know. It's all relative. Though they get all
treatment. They do take a lot of trouble to stay out of jail. So I'm assuming that no matter how comfortable the jail, they don't want to actually live there.
Certainly, but the system can be manipulated in different ways.
Yeah,
a power
true.
That the poor will not have. And those who are dissident will not have. And they will actually face the ire similarly. As I mentioned yesterday, there is a book written by a Kashmiri woman who served 10 years in Tihar jail. Called her name is Zamruda Habib. She wrote about her experience. Her book is called Qaidi Number 100, because that's the number that was assigned to her. And when you read her book, the discrimination that she faced as a Kashmiri Muslim woman was of a different order than the violence that you would generally face. That's why I'm saying you carry all your baggage into the prison, and the prison plays the same societal prejudices out. You know, Sunetra, you said something about empathy. I understand that you're saying as a writer I have to empathize, but there's a little bit of anxiety that causes me, because how will you be empathetic to an Adivasi who speaks Gondi, who neither looks nor wears nor talks like you and me? I think when we're looking at institutions, we'll have to move beyond empathy, because empathy, to my mind, has limitations. And I remember, for instance, a very small thing. When I was visiting Jagdalpur jail, and the jail superintendent was actually much better than most jail superintendents. So this woman, who was a very feisty woman. She had about 69 Naxal cases against her. And she had organized all the women prisoners. She came to the jail superintendent and said, look at this roti, it's crawling with kidas. Your atta is crawling with kidas. And he blurted without even thinking, anyway, you Adivasis eat mice. That's one of the food you eat. What are you complaining about atta having kidas? Because you don't, you know, it's not important. What you deserve is something like this. There is also a system which I would be very curious to know if it works, because what I saw in Jagdalpur was quite fascinating. There's a jail visitor system, right? They have to be people from civil society who visit the jail. They're supposed to keep... It's like a civilian oversight over what happens in prison. The jail visitor system is usually packed with... in Jagdalpur, it was the president of the Market Association and such other luminaries who have no interest in the prison or the prisoner. But there is a jail visitor system.
It's all on
so
paper.
So this is a way of, for civil society to monitor what's going on in the prison system.
Yes, okay. But it's all on paper. Nobody visits. Mm. They don't allow them to visit.
A lot of what our country, I think my original question about laws came from there, because I believe that a lot of, there is a lot of good stuff, in for want of a better, in place. It exists. There are systems that exist. There are rules that exist. We are not aware of those rules. That's
Telangana is amazing. Sorry? Telangana, jails there, and this is from Kobad Gandhi, who's been in a Delhi jail. And then he goes to Telangana.
That's because it's a new state. Now, Telangana is better in terms of policing. Everybody, you know, even DSP gets
very...
No, even
Andhra. Even the Andhra.
I think it's because
money
of the
is flowing like peanuts.
No, if I may say, it's also because it's had a long political history.
That's right.
Where people inside have been political prisoners. Yeah. And therefore, they have held to account.
That's right.
It's not a new state.
Of just giving them respect, of understanding that there are people who come in there for, and you know, little things. For example, the food, right? We all know, I'm in Kolkata, so you all know how important food is. And this cruelty perpetrated on prisoners in the way the food is treated. For example, discrimination, right? Women are given dinner, this old colonial thing, of at 5 o'clock and then locked up by 6:30 in Delhi. And men, even there, men are given dinner at 7. You tell me how many people in India are used to that. They will be woken up at 5 o'clock, they'll be given tea or breakfast at 6, lunch will be at 12, after which you'll be locked up. You will be locked up. You have to sleep, because then the officials, the jailers, can have some time off. But this food thing, you know, people can't eat at that time. So that would be another form of...
Can I just add to the food thing?
Which is different in Telangana.
Psychological.
Just so that we all heard that Ajmal Kasab was given biryani. And we heard it from no less than the special public prosecutor. So I would imagine a special public prosecutor is an important lawyer and is certainly not going to speak lies to us through the media. I would request any of you to pick up the jail manual of most of the states that I have seen. I could be wrong. Okay, so Sunetra has obviously done more research and Roopa would know the real facts. Please see what is the diet that is permitted to all prisoners. It's very detailed. How many milligrams of red chili powder, haldi, salt per prisoner, because the ration has to be created, and oil, etc. They are not even given an egg. In no jail across the country is even an egg served. It's dal, sabzi, rice, roti, dal, sabzi, rice, roti. Biryani? The man was lying, he admitted later. When you're talking about reformation, when what Sunetra's book constantly talks to us about is about human dignity. If you're going to treat somebody in an inhuman way, you are not going to be able to reform, no matter how many years you will keep that person. You have to treat a person with dignity. I'm not against a jail system. I think we do need to put people away. But when you put them away, what do you do inside over there? If you treat them in this horrific manner, that you're not a person, then that person is not going to become better. They're definitely going to become worse, and it would be equally true for any of us. So it's also about...
Adding to that, two things. One is, they're also influential people. They're able to, you know, marode the system to their favor, for example. They will say, they will bribe the prison doctor. There's always a doctor, there's a medical hospital inside the prison. So they'll tell the doctor, you please give a report in my favor that I need treatment outside in a big hospital, a specialized hospital. So it is given. So they go outside. So once they go out, you know, it's a lot of facilities, like you can roam around, go to the doctor, of course, but then go and meet your relatives or your own parents, and or you go to hotel room and so while Katara, away time.
Yeah. Nitish Katara's killers, yes. Vikas Yadav, they were only
that.
Going out on New Year's Eve to the
correct,
doctor.
Correct.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
There are people,
and
who
then they would what they do, and apparently in totality they've spent 2 years outside for treatment. Mm. But what they do is, and this is an arrangement with AIMS, they would, and Mrs. Katara, all, you know, hats off to her, Neelam Katara, she basically went, nobody would give her the information, she had to sit with the register, like, and take down those details when they gave her. And it turns out, they leave the jail early in the morning and they go to AIMS. They get the AIMS, they paid off the doctors to say, you can please come back at 5 p.m. And so they have the entire day, they check themselves into a hotel. And by the way, Manu Sharma, Jessica's killer, his father's very conveniently opened a hotel next to Tihar Jail called Piccadilly. There's in Janakpuri, there is a hotel called Piccadilly Hotel, which services all the jailers. So whoever takes care of Manu Sharma in jail, he can just go across and he's getting five-star facility there. So it's a, look at the quid pro quo. It's
true.
Immediately you are benefiting. So what was the benefit that Talwars were getting? Either way, you know, they've been acquitted now, but I went to meet them in jail. And, you know, the strange thing was, so I met them not inside a jail cell. They were sitting very comfortably in the supervisor's office, the jailer's superintendent's office. And what, as a reporter, what kept striking me was, one, they looked very well. They looked, you know, they didn't look like jail inmates. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Second, their clothes were ironed, right? Their clothes were ironed. And I kept thinking, how do you iron your clothes? And then the quid pro quo there was that they had a, they opened a clinic in jail, and entire jail officials, their families, they were great dentists, right? They had, you know, they were such famous dentists that one of the things that that writer who wrote, Patrick French, said that they can't be guilty because he has the softest hands. So this is what he said about him. So they were such famous dentists. So the entire family of all the jail officials, everyone, they were running a clinic. And in return, they had given them comfort. Of course, they've been acquitted. But I'm just saying that because they had a service to offer, and Manu Sharma's father has a hotel that people can go and stay to, that's
now,
the
similar
payoff.
Thing, this is a new thing that I'm telling you. You tell me that every time I tell you some new tidbit. There was this Gali Janardhan Reddy, who was Karnataka minister, who went to jail for mining thing. Now, of course, when I joined, he was out of jail, so he escaped my clutches. But I learned that after going there, I learned that he spent major part of his thing in Columbia Asia, five-star kind of a hospital. He spent major part of his jail days in jail term in Columbia Asia Hospital. And there, there was nice TV, air-conditioned room. Everybody could come and visit him. He could eat anything, whatever he wanted. And for the minor part for the, that he was there inside the jail, he had already started, you know, getting done a tennis court so that he could, just next to his, this one, there
just
was
like
an open space, so that he could play, you know. And that somehow that came to light by RTI, and that was stopped. But he was about to, it was almost in the finishing
stage.
So that's
what Papu Yadav says, that the first thing you go to jail, you pay off the doctor to say ki TB hai. Why TB? Because TB, the jail manual says that you can be given mutton soup.
Correct.
That's the only kind of non-veg you can get. Yeah. So everybody, he said ki main to theek tha, mujhe Lalu ji bilkul nahi pasand karte the. But Rabri was apparently soft on him, Papu Yadav. So he said that Rabri Devi got him into Patla Medical College Hospital, where he had chicken soup and he spent the whole day, and everybody couldn't come and visit you, like you're saying. So that is the payoff, that you get someone to say you have TB and you can have your non-veg then, and you know, it's all good.
I think that's a good time
there's
to
another
open
one,
it.
One last thing about drugs. That's a major menace in jails. Now, how that happens is, of course, there are people who are mentally ill inside the jails, the prisoners, and to treat them, you have these psychedelic drugs. But then they are abused. Even when you don't have that, since they give effect, so some soporific effect or sometimes this euphoric effect, they are misused. They are just taken by normal people to get that effect. And jail officials are also very permissive. They say, acha, drug liya, ganja liya. They are not bothered. Because at least, he's at least kahin to kone mein pada hua hai. He's not creating ruckus. So let it be. So this is the kind of apathy about drugs also that goes on in jails. Yeah.
Thank you for the excellent discussion. My name is Dipanjan. I would like to draw an attention to another point which was touched upon about people who are under trial. Now, we came to know some time back that there was this Kashmiri student in Aligarh Muslim University who was charged on 11 accounts, and eventually he was acquitted after 16 years and he was proved innocent. Another instance is somebody like Kanhaiya Kumar. Now, all these people were sent to places like Tihar Jail and all. Now, we can't change the entire system overnight, but can we look at there being separate jails for people under trial and people who are convicted?
Before you answer that question, there's a difference. We talked about the prison system today, not the legal system.
Even inside the jails, there are different enclaves. So, under trials are separated. There is, even in, for example, in Bengaluru jail, there's a wide road separating. The convicts are this side, and the under trials are kept this side. They are supposed not to mix because, of course.
But the convicts work.
But the point is, when they aram se ghumte hain, matlab aisa nahi ki hamesha taala laga ke rehte hain. So they do come in contact. But of course, there are separate enclaves. But
if I can just add one thing, you're absolutely right. I think it's extremely important to speak about under trials. The issue of what is wrong with the maladies in the prison system today is largely around the under trial issue. About 60 to 70% of the prison population today is only under trials. And there are certain kinds of under trials who will not get bail. Other under trials will get bail, no matter what is the nature of the case. And it's again about class, caste, all various dimensions of power and money, of course. And there are many such under trials. You mentioned one student. There is a book that you can read of Muhammad Amir, who went into prison on various terror cases were put on him. He was a young boy of 19 years old. After about 16 or 17 years, I forget how many years, because he was put, every bomb blast case in and around Delhi was put on him, which works very well because all of us stop asking any question whatsoever. Oh my God, he's a terror guy, why should we talk about his case? He's acquitted. He has come out. His family, of course, his father is dead, mother is paralyzed. After 17 years, he has come out of jail. And therefore, the under trial issue in the prison system is extremely important. For 4 years, from 2011 to about 2014, the highest under trial population in India was in Chhattisgarh, yeah, where there is a counter insurgency operation happening. Villages have been put into jail because that is one way in which the government is carrying out its operations.
All right. Hi, madam. My name is Srijon. I was there at the discussion when Sunetra madam was saying that there's only one psychologist for, I think, I don't know, I don't remember the exact number of inmates.
In Tihar,
right, yeah. So the moment you said about the Talwars offering service to the inmates and to the police, I remember the movie Shawshank Redemption. I think we have all seen the movie where the lead character was also providing some kind of service in return for some kind of favor from the police department. So I think this goes on everywhere. I mean, in movies and also in real life.
Is there a question?
Yeah. So in Shawshank Redemption, I saw there was this one problem. There was this old librarian and they used this term that he got institutionalized while staying in the prison for a long, long time. And when he was released, he committed suicide because he had nothing to do. I think people who are under trial and also people who have stayed inside prison for a long, long time, they often break down, their spirits break down, and when they get released, they don't know what to do. And I think
I'll just take that. What happens under trials, we are not supposed to give them any work because they are still not punished. They are they're still innocent in the eyes of law. And therefore, they are not even supposed to do any menial work like cleaning toilets or anything. But of course, money and caste, as she said, it plays there also inside the jails. And people under trials, the underdogs among them, are made to do the menial work like cleaning the toilets or the floors and other things. But about preparing them for coming out for the life after they come out, we are supposed to give vocational training like. It could be carpentry or teaching them bakery classes or any other thing, blacksmithy. All these things are there. They're very much in rules and even the facilities are there. But like I saw, what I saw in Bengaluru jail, the capacity is very less. For example, the blacksmithy class can at a time take just 50 people. There is this dyeing thing which can also cater for about just 100 people. But how many are the convicts? About 1,000 are the convicts. 3,000 are under trials in Bengaluru prison. So 1,000 convicts, there is no work. So all these classes, the vocational training, everything, maximum they take up about 200 to 300 or 400. Others are all just whiling away time because there's no capacity built there. There also has to be capacity building, which is not looked into by the prison officials. That's a very neglected area. So that is why they're suffering. And the women prisoners, women convicts were about 100. So they have also been taught many skills, including beauty parlor, beautician courses and all. But there is no outlet to try right now, and they keep doing it on each other. That is also a part of the story. They keep giving massages to the VIPs like Shashikala who comes, and they take money from her, of course. But we have to build capacity. Otherwise, the moment they come out, they really don't know what to do. But of course, we do keep trying to do this. And in Tumkuru jail, we had just now set up this bakery thing, so that the moment they go out, they know how to bake and can get either an employment in a bakery or start something of their own. Including, we had also tried to arrange loans from banks for those who are getting released. But all the jails, they really don't have this capacity which can cater to all the prisoners to teach them anything vocational.
Okay, we have one last question, I think. I don't think we have... Quickly okay. Ask your question.
Very good afternoon to all four of you present. My question has two parts. Like, is there any provision for the convicts to engage themselves in cultural activities, like since we have already known of Nigel Akara? And also another question, that the prison houses, they also lock up mad and clinically insane. Like, we have a very famous book by Meenakshi Mukherjee called Pagol Jailer Bhitor Jail, which entirely talks
prison
of...
Prison inside prison.
Which entirely talks of the conviction and the locking up of mad, insane women. So could you enlighten us on mad, insane people being
yes,
locked
Yes, cultural
up?
Thing, yes, we do encourage. And there is a troupe in Bengaluru jail which keeps going and performs. We give them security, we take them to various places, they perform and come back. So that is there. But nobody takes interest even in that. Sometimes it all depends on the jail officials. If they take interest, they will call the people who can teach them dance, music, and they'll get it done. But after that jailer is gone, or the jail superintendent is gone, then it depends on the person who is there. If he's not interested, he'll not allow these things to be done in jail. So it all depends on them.
And I think the incarceration of the criminally insane can become a whole new sort of topic for discussion. We can actually have a session on that, I think. Where's the microphone? Peradidichu.
Hi. It was very most enlightening. You mentioned Telangana as one of the states which has had a reformed jail system in some sense. And I was reminded that India has had an independence movement where there has been significant power shifts, as have certain states where... Sorry, you're laughing.
The power shift...
Right. Certain states have possibly had greater political revolutions than other states. And I was just curious, why does this sort of not enter more mainstream politics? Is it a stigma, or is it more of a caste system?
You don't have a... people in jail can't vote.
And is there
people
a...
People who are you know, accused, and they can fight elections from jail.
I'm just going to say that. You can contest an election, but you can't vote. That's the present...
That's right. They're not... As soon as you make them a vote bank, prison reforms...
Correct. Since they're not a vote bank, they are not of interest to anybody. You know, if you are in vote bank, a politician will suddenly jump there and, you know, try to do something or pose to do something to gain votes.
Although I think it's a very good idea, but one should be pushing that. Why should a prisoner not have a say in the way in which country is run? You know, I mean, I'm still a citizen of the country. Therefore, my rights cannot be taken away. This is a civil right I have. But somebody has to decide this at some point of time.
She has a...
Yeah.
Okay, Payal has asked a very short but a very deep question. Who is responsible,
actually? Criminal justice system. Like, even outside the jails, we are not happy about how it works, right? The working of the police or the bureaucracy. So who is responsible outside even? We all are, because we all have our own powers, laws, manuals, rules. Even the constitution of the country has created the creamy bureaucrats, that is the IAS and IPS. They're no less. But hardly they realize their powers and start exercising. They don't. So the day they do that, I think even including jails, there will be a better place. So as I said, it all depends on what kind of a jailer or a jail superintendent is there. If they are demonic, then really prisoners go experience the hell. But if they are good, yes, prisoners also have a good time. So it all depends on each one of us. We shouldn't say, okay, let the help come from there or let them do. We all have to start.
Basically, I think we all have to do our jobs, is what Roopa is saying. Everybody needs to do their jobs. The system is in place. It's when you don't, what you make of that system that leads to certain situations, I think. And also, Vrinda would, of course, say
I feel we need to hold ourselves also accountable. We don't ask questions about the prison system. It should be and was meant to be a place of reform and rehabilitation where you have to repent for what you have done but come out and come out as a better person. And we have stopped asking any questions about the prison system because we are very happy to have people locked away forever. And when they come out, they're only going to create more trouble because of the hellhole that we've created. So we need to ask questions about what's happening in the prison. We need to hold prison officials accountable. And when people like Roopa are shunted out for being whistleblowers, we need to raise a noise about it. I think as a society, we have decided that there are bad people and we are good people. And that's not the way any society can function.
Thank you. I think that's a very good note on which to end the session, Vrinda. No further words need be added. Thank you very much.